persuasive, I think.
And You're a young man. Uh-huh. Raise your voice so people can hear you.
Oh, I didn't realize my volume was an issue. Okay.
Yes.
So, one of the successful pieces of legislation, I was able to get all of my colleagues pretty much to sign on to a weapons registry bill that addresses weapons coming to the territory. From the time I ran in 2008, my platform has included several areas, and one of them is crime. And so this bill really resulted from listening to testimony from the police commissioners, first Commissioner Carrad and then Commissioner Richards. So it goes back to the 30th legislature, but I wasn't successful in getting it moved in the 30th. Mm-hmm. And so there was this issue of what happens when guns are bought legally in the United States in some state and then transported to the territory. And so when the weapons arrived, then the responsibility of the person bringing the weapon into the territory was to then register it with the police commissioner. And of course, that would take place in a facility outside of the port. And so that would mean that the person bringing this weapon into the territory would then have to find the police commissioner and complete the appropriate registration. And I kept thinking about that as an unsatisfactory way to deal with the situation. And so I proposed to both the Commissioner of Police and the Department of Justice a different approach, really, to looking at this. And that would involve having a police presence at the port to ensure that the registration of a weapon would take place immediately upon entry. Because I think we can all foresee that if you have to leave the port, the possibility of the registration not taking place and the possibility of the weapon ending up in the illegal stream of weapons in the territory, that those were two great possibilities. And so the bill was recently passed by the legislature and signed into law by Governor Mapp. And what it does is that it requires the immediate registration upon arrival in the territory, one, and it also creates a new felony charge that would attach as soon as the person bringing the weapon into the territory left the port, failing to make such a declaration and such a registration. And so it gives the underpinnings of a means of looking at weapons coming into the territory and controlling those. Because when you register, it also gives the police authorities the opportunity to say, well, this or that type of weapon is not permitted in the territory, and to then confiscate it at that point. So I believe that's an important piece in crime fighting in the territory and bringing the weapons coming in under control. Because I don't believe that a lot of people understand how very easy it is to purchase a weapon and then bring it into the territory. That accounts for a lot of the weapons that come in. You can go on the TSA website and read the appropriate ways to do this. The airlines will give you the regulation, and you pack it appropriately, and you're good to go. So that's one measure. I've also had as a pivotal piece of my campaign the education of young people, and particularly helping to provide access to young people for higher education. And so it began in the 30th legislature, where I introduced the bill. I know you're hearing people on the federal level talking about it, but a bill to provide tuition-free admission for our resident students to our state university, which is really the University of the Virgin Islands. Of course, everybody testified in favor of that bill, but I'm still working on a funding source for that measure. In the meantime, what I did get accomplished was I got an amendment to the Hotel Development Act, which provides that every new development in the territory will have to provide $200,000 worth of scholarships to students who want to study hotel management or in some related field. And so that act was passed, that was signed into law.
Was it collectively or individually?
Individually, and annually, right, to support students in those areas. So that was signed into law. And then just recently, I think when you become a senator, you have to constantly be observing the pieces in your community that you believe need to be addressed by legislation. And when I went to the adult continuing ed graduation last year, last graduating year, one of the things that came to my attention as I sat there on the stage and as I engaged people in the audience is that those graduates don't get the Val or the Sal scholarships. And I was saying, well, here we are. We're encouraging them to pursue higher education. One, we've made them complete essentially the same requirements as students in the day program. What keeps us from extending this opportunity to them to continue their studies as well? So I came back and I said to my colleagues, I said, you know, I don't think this is a good thing that these young people, because many of them are not that much older than the students in the day program. They may have been in a fight, they may have had a pregnancy, whatever reason. They have just come out of the traditional program. So my colleagues agreed, and again, I was successful in getting that legislation amended so that the students in that program will qualify for the Valenzuela scholarships when they graduate.
Very good. I was in that program for 25 years.
Yeah, man, I remember.
That's very good. I'm happy for that.
Good. And then I have a pending amendment, something that we will come to at some point, which looks at the EDC program. And right now, when those companies get benefits in the territory, they're required to contribute $3,000 to scholarships to the Board of Education.
I'm familiar with that.
Yeah. And what I want to see that change to is I want them to contribute the equivalent of one full-time scholarship to the University of the Virgin Islands instead, which would bring it to around $7,000. And that is still up for discussion with my colleagues, but I believe that we should commit to at least one full-time scholarship.
I'm happy to hear that because I was a proponent of that law. Mm-hmm. And the colleague said I should have gone to $10,000, but I said, no, I'm not going to.
Well, we'll take steps.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think we have to recognize that there are other contributions that they make to the Department of Labor and charitable contributions as well. But I would like to see that scholarship amount increased to meaningfully assist our students. And I think one of the things, you know, as senators, you get criticized a lot. But when you look at our students and you see them coming out of school and they get a scholarship for $1,600, these are students that communicate with us, and I think it's incumbent on us to just keep trying to find as many ways as possible to continue to support them in their educational pursuits. So I was very happy to have those students passed as well. Then I just wanted to share a little information because, you know, in the news is our government employees' retirement system, and that's a really big part of the financial picture of the Virgin Islands. And in the last session, I was really one of the colleagues who participated in a discussion about how we would approach this borrowing bill that the governor has sent down. And the governor sent down a borrowing bill which amounted to probably about $426 million. And of that $426 million, the only mention of the GERS was the $5 million to the infrastructure needs at the Havenside Mall. When we had all kinds of differing opinions about these projects, and when we got into a discussion, Senator Leibert was really the person who started off the discussion, and he said, just to put it in context, that was the same week that we had been in a meeting with GERS. So we were in a meeting with GERS the Monday, and this session was 3 days, so it was Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. So it's the same week that you got this harrowing information about 30% cut in annuities. Yeah. And so it was Senator Leibert who first began the discussion, and he said, you know, we're talking about this bonding bill. I don't think we're paying enough attention to the seriousness of GERS. And then the conversation went all over the place. When it was my turn to speak, I said, I want to come back to where Senator Leibert stopped off, because I really don't believe we paid enough attention to what he said and to the critical nature of this problem.
That is how the community is feeling exactly that way, and not sufficient attention paid to that issue.
Mm-hmm. And so the caveat to my comments was, I said, you know, we have to remember that when we're talking about these annuities, we're talking about the tier one people, and there are many of those people who retired when government salaries were not as high as 20,000. the minimum $20,000 salary came during the time of some of these retirees. So some of them might have retired with less than that. And so we have to then think about a person receiving such an annuity and getting a 30% cut to live in this economy. And I said, you know, I have traditionally not supported borrowing. I mean, you can look at the record and I've voted against these budgets that have had borrowing. I said, but I can see myself supporting it only if we make some payment into GERS. And yes, we understand that the system says it needs $1.4 to $1.7 billion. But realistically, all of us know that the government of the Virgin Islands cannot access, in one instance, $1.4 billion to put into the system. So we're faced with the question, well, if I tell you I need $1 million and you tell me you're going to give me $100,000, what would I say? I don't want it? No. Or the question, if I can't put in $1.4 billion or I can't put in $1.7 billion, should I do nothing? And the conversation just went round and round and everybody put their 2 cents in. And eventually, we came to a consensus. If we're going to do this borrowing for the working capital, we're going to add at a minimum $100 million to it for the GERS. And so that bill was drafted up by the legal counsel and eventually voted into law. And I would just like to say to persons as well that although there are people who might scoff at that and say, well, $100 million is not enough, I certainly don't think it's nothing, but it's not in a vacuum. You have to remember that one of the things the 30th legislature did, the 31st, was when we, through that tax case, became having a controlling interest in this lonesome dove, one of the actions we did was to make all the proceeds of that go into GERS with the exception of, I think, maybe the first $500,000, which is going to support the senior citizen centers.
Is there a connection also with Diageo?
I'm doing some research on that component of it because I was, the Diageo measure preceded me in the legislature. So there's some work I'm doing on that. But we also, when we met with GERS, one of the things that the actuary spoke about was having a dedicated tax, which really what they're talking about, whether you want to think about it as a tax or not, but a dedicated stream of income into the retirement system separate from the contributions. Because what one of the things we have to realize is when the system was flourishing, you had about four employees to every person who was retired, and that ratio has now changed to 1-to-1. So obviously, you have to think about streams of income separate from just the government.
If you don't want to increase the membership, that's
another idea. And in fact, I'll come to that in 1 second. That you think about dedicated streams of income, because when we had the...
Give me a minute. Let me ID. Okay. ID. After the hour.
It's another day in paradise for the wealthy boys of the West Indies.
Okay, you can proceed. Let me check it out.
So, the discussion of the actuaries was about other approaches. So you have one approach is to put in $1.4 billion. You have another approach which is to talk about increasing the numbers of people who are paying into your system. You have another approach which is increasing the contributions. And then you have another approach which is a dedicated stream of income. And so that lonesome dove represents one. But there are others of us who have ideas about some other streams of income. So one of my proposals, and I know that people don't like to think about additional taxes, but I did propose a tax on the individual sale of alcoholic beverages. And when I considered the tax the first time...
You mean retail sales?
Retail sales. Like when you go to a bar. When you go to a restaurant.
You're going
to
get some glue.
Well, first let me explain it. Well, it's either that or you have a system that collapses. Yeah. So you have one on one hand and one on the other. So we have 3 million people coming to the territory. And what a lot of them come here to do is drink. And a lot of that is retail. A lot of it is retail sales. So when I thought about it, I said, well, Let me speak first to the Internal Revenue Bureau and find out from them the difficulty in collecting the tax for the first thing. And they said, well, Roach, you know, it's not that difficult because we already collect the data broken down into categories like that. If you go to a restaurant and you buy your meal and you buy a glass of wine, the wine is already itemized on the receipt. And we already are recording somewhere between $16 and $19 million annually in those kinds of sales. So if you were to think about a tax that would put on 50 cents on a drink or 60 cents on a drink, I think these are things we have to consider. We have to go outside of the box. It's a discretionary act, so you're not taxing food and you're not taxing clothing. It's an act that people do and participating when they feel good. And I think when you think that the possibility that you can help to save a system by putting a stream of income into it that you can leverage as well over time, these are the things that we have to put on the table. Everybody may not agree with it, the colleagues may not agree with it, but what the actuaries said is when you approach a contribution that is putting in something like at least 10% of what the system's needs are, then you begin to affect it in a positive way.
Let me ask you this. Would that have any impact on a business such as a restaurant or a shop? Gross receipts.
Well, you would pay. You still would pay gross receipts tax on the sales, but it would be an additional drink tax. And they're all in the category of the taxes we call sin taxes. So that's one idea that
I've put. There's another sin tax. Another tax you want to add, which is a real sin.
Which one?
Prostitution.
Well, that's not on my platform. I will save that time. I'll let you have that discussion with someone else who brings.
Not me.
Yeah.
Oh God.
Then of course, so that's a GRS piece, and then I wanted to add, with regard to, so we talk about the education on one hand, we talk about the retirement system, and my platform also is addressed to the needs of.
Well, let me ask you quickly. Go back quickly to the retirement system. What have you studied? How can you make the government accountable for their role in the GRS system?
Well, I think in order to do that, I think you have to look at what has happened with past and current legislatures. Because I think in the present time, the government is not as derelict in terms of the contributions going into GRS. The massive portion has to do with previous legislatures, and I have to say they're previous because I'm only here 3 years, going on four, that passed retirement programs that were not funded. I mean, essentially, that's the undercurrent right there. And so the unfunded liability is really what has brought the system to where it is, in addition to the other issues of the declining numbers of government employees. There are those people who think government is too big. There are those people who continue to advocate for the reduction of the government workforce. But when you do that, there are consequences as well to impact the retirees. So you it's like trying to fix a moving train. I always use that kind of reference because you can't stop it. You're working on it as it's moving in progress.
But is it important that the government maintain a certain level of employees?
Mm-hmm.
In order to stabilize the system.
Right. Now, in addition to that, there has been a conversation about systems that have public systems that also have people who are privately employed. And one state, I think it's California, is experimenting with that.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the issue with that is private retirement systems are more the regulations covering them are more stricter, more stringent, and so you can have a retirement system that may have in a certain number of privately employed persons, but if you have too many, it starts to resemble a private system, and then the federal regulations are tighter. Just yesterday, we had a meeting with the Chamber of Commerce, and that idea was put on the table. Because, you know, a lot of people who are privately employed have neither 401ks nor retirement plans, right? And so there is this discussion of this de minimis number of employees, but of course you would have to then have an employer who's willing to pay what is the equivalent of the government share on behalf of such an employee, and of course the employee having to put in the same percentage, you know, that the government employees do. So, I've had that discussion with GRS going back to when I first entered the legislature. I just wanted to add the other piece, which is my program of being aware, too, of the needs of the elderly. And I was one of the persons who was a strong advocate when there were reductions in the senior citizens operating, and in fact, when one of the centers in St. John was threatened. So recently what I also got through was an amendment to address the critical needs, emergency needs at the Queen Louise Home for the Aged because of my visits to that facility and responding to what persons identified as critical needs to help the seniors there for critical equipment, critical repairs such as electrical repairs, a fire alarm system, etc. So that has been my work in trying to address that portion of the population. And then just recently, my most recent submission is a bill to acquire a facility that would help with the provision of social services to those persons with mental illness. So I'm working on that measure.
I'm happy to hear that. Because the homeless need shelter, supervised shelter. And an appropriate place must be either be developed or identified for that purpose. When you go in Emancipation Garden in the evening, you got to fight for a bench.
Oh, yeah. So we're working on that one. And then I did a special a program with the aftercare. So the students who live in the communities of Savan, Garden Street, Don Street, and Solberg, I was able to get an amendment through for the provision of after-school services to those children. And it's actually a collaboration because it's being done through a private nonprofit entity, which is the Methodist Outreach Services. So I was happy to be the sponsor of that legislation as well. And one of the things that I've been looking at with regard to the property taxes, and that is in response to my St. Johnian constituents who have really been the most severely impacted by property tax increases in the territory. And they really, it's like a double whammy because the presence of the federal government through the national park means that somewhere between 60 and 72% of the land is removed from use either for residential or commercial development. And, you know, it's really a paradox because you never think of a national park in your community being an area of concern. But of course, what that has done is the remaining land, it's significantly high in terms of the cost of land, and then the tax rates are also higher and tax bills are higher. So one of the things that I came up with is if we can look at what's called a federal impact, federal lands impact tax credit. And so it would reflect the ownership of federal land in a particular island and would create a credit and at first I thought about it for St. John, but then I said, well, I don't want to have any constitutional challenges that it's available to one set of residents in a district and not others. So I asked the Lieutenant Governor's office to work on a formula that we would determine the percentage of federal land on each island. And so there would be a credit that would be available to each person. So I'm working on that.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear it because I think I left a piece of legislation similar to that with somebody, similar to what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. But the other question I had in mind quickly was whether or not, I doubted it, but I would throw it out there, whether or not a federal parkland can be taxed.
Well, what the federal government does is the federal government actually makes a payment for lands in jurisdictions where they control.
One payment?
Yeah. It's a payment in lieu of taxes. And you will find that they do it
That's not an annual payment.
Yeah.
It is?
Oh, yeah. They do it in Alaska.
It is for St. John?
It's like $3 an acre. But it's like $3 an acre. Right. But you would be pleased to know that, I mean, this is a joke. I'm making a joke.
Yeah.
I hope people don't take me seriously. Yeah. But you'll be happy to know that it's much higher than in a lot of other places. So in Alaska and California, they get a lower rate than we do. Yeah. But that's what it is.
$3 an acre is really a joke.
Yeah, and it's probably one of those things that's said by who? Congress.
Probably Interior Department.
Oh, right, you know. So, and that, of course, doesn't come anywhere near the payment should be. But that's what it is. It's somewhere around that. In places where they own millions of acres, like Alaska and so forth, the payment is much less per acre. But it creates a lot of issues. You have the St. Johnians who talk about, you know, traditionally being able to go into the forests or into the lands that are now park, collecting reeds to make baskets.
Some can get access to their own property.
Some can get access to property, etc. And of course, fishing, you know, where the monuments are and where people have traditionally been able to do one thing or the other.
I was almost arrested for picking up rooks at Harkness Bay.
You see that? Yeah. So it's a real issue.
All right.
So that was my legislation in that area. So I want to thank you, you know, for the opportunity to come on the program.
You still have two more minutes.
Two more.
Yeah.
I'd like to mention this last one, and one of the things as well is to have the foresight to think about problems coming down the pike. You know, a lot of the times,
futuristically,
we have to move from just responding and to really planning. And so what I'm engaged in with the Green Technology Center at the university is trying to forge a policy on climate change for the Virgin Islands. Because a lot of us might not be paying attention to it, but we happen to live in areas, some of which are below sea level.
Mm-hmm.
We happen to have an economy that is
based on
the sea and the appropriate uses of our coastal lands, mm-hmm. which are going to be impacted by climate change. We are living in areas where the rainfall is going to be affected. And so our ability and our planning for the storage of something essential as water, all of these things we have to take into consideration. And so I have a bill in for that program. We already had some workshops because what the Green Technology Center did was it brought in some scientists from the region that are already working in the area of climate change. They came from the University of the West Indies. And the programs were attended by a cross-section of the territory, civic leaders, students, policymakers, representatives of government agencies such as the Department of Planning.